Today we have a moving tale from the past and the present. Back when Glenn Greenwald still wrote for The Intercept, and if you want to know why he doesn't still, just go back to previous shows where I explain that, he documented how the animal agriculture industry surveils and punishes critics. And he mentioned a respected Bay Area veterinarian who endured widespread attacks following an industry alert about her criticisms of factory farms. This article was written back in the Trump era when everything was much worse than it is now, right? Back in those dark days, people like Dr. Crystal Heath, one of the veterinarians targeted by these industry campaigns for retaliation, were persecuted not only by industry campaigns, but by our wonderful government. A common theme on this show is that government is being run by corporations, and here's more evidence back from October of last year. It's collusion, pure and simple. Animal agriculture industry groups defending factory farms engage in campaigns of surveillance, reputation destruction, and other forms of retaliation against industry critics and animal rights activists. Documents obtained through a FOIA request from the U.S. Department of Agriculture reveal that the USDA possesses these emails and other documents demonstrates the federal government's knowledge of, if not participation in, these industry campaigns. So here's an example of the government directly oppressing citizens who are against factory farms and how they work. These documents detail ongoing monitoring of the social media of news outlets, including The Intercept, which report critically on factory farms. They reveal private surveillance activities aimed at animal rights groups and their members. They include discussions of how to create a climate of intimidation for activists who work against industry abuses, including by photographing the activists and publishing the photos online. This is our government. This is what our government is doing. And they describe a coordinated ostracization campaign that specifically targets veterinarians who criticize industry practices out of concern that veterinarians are uniquely well-positioned to persuasively and powerfully denounce industry abuses. One of the industry groups central to these activities is the Animal Agriculture Alliance, which represents factory farms and other animal agriculture companies, but they're operating on behalf of our government. Or as they playfully put it, they work for corporations involved in getting food from the farm to our forks. The group boasts that one of its prime functions is monitoring activism, by which they mean we identify emerging threats and provide insightful resources on animal rights and other activist groups by attending their events, monitoring traditional and social media, and engaging our national network. Whoa. Skipping ahead. In the emails obtained by the FOIA request, the Alliance and its allies frequently encouraged their members to alert the FBI and Department of Homeland Security regarding actions by activists. So is our government involved in this? Hell yes. Skipping ahead again, one person singled out for retaliation in these discussions was a popular, respected Bay Area veterinarian, Dr. Crystal Heath. As a local CBS affiliate television profile of her explained, Dr. Heath is the kind of veterinarian who we all as children are taught to admire. Rather than working for corporations or state agencies meaning the government, engaged in cruel animal experimentation or for factory farms making a large salary to provide the veneer of medical justification for their barbaric, torturous practices, Dr. Heath has devoted herself to shelter medicine, working for years with the Berkeley Humane Society and other nonprofit animal rescue groups where she has spayed and neutered more than 20,000 animals. And then Glenn goes on to explain how this wonderful person has been persecuted not only by the Animal Agriculture Alliance and its industry allies, but also our frickin' government. He also details a gruesome mass extermination technique being used by Iowa's largest pork producer, Iowa Select Farms, to kill large numbers of pigs which were deemed unnecessary and in need of depopulation due to the pandemic. The technique, called ventilation shutdown, or VSD, involves cutting off the air supply in barns and turning up the heat to intense levels so that most pigs, though not all, die after hours of suffering from a combination of being suffocated and roasted to death. That kind of sounds like what the US government, under Joe Biden, is doing to its citizens post-COVID. The pigs who survive this excruciating ordeal are then shot in the head in the morning by farm employees. A video report produced by The Intercept and the video documentarian Leighton Woodhouse, based on footage obtained inside an Iowa Select barn by DXE as the pigs were slowly dying, was viewed by more than 150,000 people. And here's a good place to segue to the video documentarian Leighton Woodhouse. Now that Glenn doesn't work for The Intercept anymore and has his own Substack, he's also including other voices, outside voices, as he calls them. Here is a very recent article by that same Leighton Akira Woodhouse. The point of all this is to show you that our transition from Trump to Biden hasn't changed the way our government operates one iota. If you believe that things are much better now, you've been propagandized. So Leighton's article is called "The Targets of Biden's War on Domestic Extremists," and we've talked about domestic extremists before, may not be who you think. We've also pointed out in the past that the CIA is not supposed to be picking on domestic extremists. The CIA is supposed to be dealing with international extremists. They are not authorized to deal with domestic extremists. So Biden's war on domestic extremists is not just a war on people that you wouldn't like, it's a war on people like me. Well, maybe you don't like me, I don't know. But by Biden's definition, lots of us are domestic extremists. The subtitle says, "Illustrating the dangers of the federal government's war on domestic extremists, animal rights activists are being prosecuted under a capacious definition of terrorism." Based on information like this, I keep waiting for them to come for me in the night next. Right at the top of the article is a picture of all these dead pigs and an employee saying, "So where was this camera at in terms of what would be in its range of sight?" This is from an undercover video taken by the animal rights group DXE at Iowa Select Farms, May 19th, 2020. Last May, several months into a global pandemic that had capsized the economy, hog farmers had a problem on their hands. With restaurants closed, demand for their product had evaporated. With outbreaks shuttering meat processing plants all over the country, they had nowhere to send their animals to be slaughtered. If kept alive, the pigs would quickly outgrow facilities designed to hold them only for highly abbreviated lives, and the costs of feeding and watering them would become astronomical. So some major pork producers, among them Iowa's largest, Iowa Select Farms, made a horrifying decision. They would mass exterminate their animals in one fell swoop using a technique that promised efficiency for themselves but guaranteed incomprehensible suffering for the pigs. So as I've already explained, it's called ventilation shutdown and it entails basically roasting the pigs alive. They close all the vents into the barns, shut down the air conditioning, and pipe steam into the buildings. I didn't read that before. And pipe steam into the buildings until the animals die by asphyxiation or hyperthermia, a process that takes several hours. And then a worker walks through the piles of corpses with the captive bolt gun, shooting whatever stragglers had survived. If our government would allow this sort of treatment for pigs, what sort of treatment would it allow for us humans who they deem to be extraneous? This company, Iowa Select Farms, however, was unaware that there was a whistleblower within their ranks, an ISF truck driver named Lucas Walker, who had long been appalled by the company's treatment of its pigs, had informed an activist named Matt Johnson of the company's plans. Johnson snuck into the barns, placed hidden cameras, and recorded video and audio of the massacre to later release to the news media. An Iowa Select Farms worker on May 19, 2020, carrying a gun in a barn after ventilation shutdown has been used to kill excess pigs. Neither Johnson nor Walker is what most people of conscience would consider a dangerous political extremist. They had no desire to bring any physical harm to anyone. On the contrary, they were moved by the cause of putting a halt to needless suffering. But both a new state law in Iowa, I wonder where that came from, and a bill currently being considered in Congress could render them such in the eyes of the criminal justice system. You're going to make people like that become criminals. Not only criminals, terrorists. It is just one example of the moral hazard posed by the ongoing effort in Congress and within the Biden administration to erect a new domestic security state apparatus in response to the Trump years and the Capitol riot, an effort the CIA has joined, while animal rights groups and environmental campaigners have been explicitly listed among its targets. That's our fucking government. The CIA is part of this. In 2011, Iowa Select Farms had been the subject of an undercover investigation by the animal rights group Mercy for Animals. Liz Pashot, an animal rights activist with MFA, had taken a job at the farm and, over the course of 4 months, documented appalling conditions there with an undercover camera. When the gruesome footage was released, it caused a major crisis for ISF, with numerous grocery chains dropping the company as a supplier. The following year, the animal agriculture industry successfully lobbied the Iowa State Legislature to make what Pashot had done a crime. When are they going to make what I'm doing a crime? Make no mistake, folks, you're not supposed to know about this stuff. Are you going to see this information on MSDNC? This law was one of many so-called ag-gag laws in agriculture states across the country, which make undercover investigations on factory farms by animal rights groups unlawful. An estimated 99% of animals raised for meat are factory farmed. The very few small family farms that are left are being systematically driven out of business by the industrialization and economic consolidation of the industry. Just think Amazon and Walmart with regard to the mom-and-pop stores all over the country. Another example is mom-and-pop trucking companies. These huge corporations, backed up by our CIA, are taking over everything. Fast forward, then a new governor took office in Iowa. Kim Reynolds had won her office in 2018 with the conspicuous help of Iowa Select Farms. Iowa Select Farms co-owners Jeff and Deborah Hansen have donated nearly $300,000 to Governor Reynolds. During the 2018 race, Deborah was the governor's biggest individual campaign contributor. Kim Reynolds had been the guest of honor at the Hansen's Family Foundation. Governor Reynolds had barely been in office a month before a newly rewritten ag gag bill was introduced into the legislature. By summer, she had signed it into law. And that, dear viewers and listeners, is how it works. Now back to Matt Johnson. Johnson has become the first person to be charged under the 2019 Ag Gag Law for attempting to enter one ISF facility. He is facing a separate wiretap charge for the hidden cameras in the barn where the company carried out its ventilation shutdown. In the meantime, yet another Ag Gag Law has passed through the Iowa legislature, which increases penalties for the crime of planting hidden cameras in animal agriculture facilities. Governor Reynolds is expected to sign the new bill into law any day now. As should surprise nobody who lived through the political aftermath of 9/11, these laws were passed under the pretext of combating terrorism. Radical animal rights and environmental activists have, in fact, long been among the FBI's top domestic terrorism targets, as well as targets of draconian new legislation. In 2006, at the behest of the pharmaceutical and animal agriculture industries, Congress passed a law specifically defining animal rights activism aimed at damaging or interfering with the operations of an animal enterprise, whether or not violence was involved, as terrorism. Direct Action Everywhere, DXE, the group Johnson belongs to, I used to cover DXE as a reporter and have since become a member myself, was the subject of a major FBI investigation over the theft of two dying piglets from a factory farm. After he was discovered, the FBI interviewed Walker, asking him if DXE sells drugs or guns to finance their activism, and tried to recruit him as an informant into their activities. Your government working for you. This dismal history should be an obvious cautionary tale about the hazards of enhancing the state's power to surveil and prosecute people for politically motivated activity beyond the ample criminal laws already on the books. But in the wake of the January 6th MAGA Capitol riot, progressives in particular have gained an appetite for more. So not only is it bad under Biden, it's actually worse. Currently, a bill with 196 Democratic co-sponsors and 3 Republicans is before Congress, which would begin to build the legal and bureaucratic architecture for an interagency domestic terrorism response unit within the Department of Justice, the FBI, and the Department of Homeland Security. The legislation is explicitly a response to the Capitol riot and is pointed particularly at white supremacist and neo-Nazi groups, a particularly unsympathetic and uncontroversial cast of culprits. But wait for it, dear viewers and listeners. You know this response is going to be targeting leftists, as the CIA and FBI have done from their inception, and this is just a pretense. They're not after white supremacists and neo-Nazis. They're after leftists. It's a trick! The Patriot Act was also purported to target only the most hateful, murderous people in the world, Islamic terrorists, before it metastasized into a massive surveillance state infrastructure that spied on literally every single American with an internet connection. Are we to expect that a domestic analog to the Patriot Act will draw the line at violent sociopathic racists? The intelligence community demonstrably does not. A recently declassified report lists animal rights and environmental activists, abortion activists on both the pro-life and the pro-choice sides, anarchists, and anti-capitalists as potential domestic terrorist threats. If we've learned anything from the last few years, it's that corporations are all too eager to co-opt the progressive rhetoric du jour, whether to sell sneakers or to protect themselves against workplace discrimination lawsuits. And the FBI has been more than willing to investigate activists engaged in nonviolent activities as terrorists under the 2006 Animal Enterprise Terrorism Act. A new domestic federal law enforcement bureaucracy dedicated to surveilling and investigating anyone the government claims to suspect is a terrorist would be a bonanza to industries facing concerted activist pressure, whether animal agriculture or fossil fuels, or a company in any industry facing a unionization drive. What possible reason is there to believe that corporations won't lobby the Biden administration and future administrations to use their new powers to ensnare activists who campaign against them, all in the name of ridding the country of violent political extremists and insurrectionists? The answer is that there is no reason to believe it, and every reason to believe the hunt for domestic terrorists could eventually be turned against anyone with the will and the means to effectively confront those who hold concentrated political and corporate power, including through strictly nonviolent means. A demonstrated willingness to use violence has never been a requisite for law enforcement agencies to brand those they wish to malign as terrorists, as DXC activists know all too well. All that's required is their willingness to use the label. After 9/11, the passage of the Patriot Act was enabled by the bullying of dissidents in a climate of enforced jingoism. It was dangerous to ask critical questions then. Safety was found only in conformity. We're in such a moment again, but this time from within a liberal rather than a right-wing consensus. But the outcome will be the same. The hardening of state power made possible through organized collective hysteria. And who, dear viewers and listeners, is paying attention to this shit? Look what YouTube is doing to me. They're ensuring that I can't make any money doing this, and they're also ensuring that I won't get any widespread distribution through their algorithms. I have a minuscule voice, and with this new legislation in sight, if I'm deemed a terrorist, I soon will have no voice at all.